We have already encountered a few situations that may create short-term alterations of our protein balance. For example, if we skip a couple of meals, fast for a whole day, perform strenuous resistance training to the point of depleting our glycogen stores, then we may have to use some of our muscle proteins to maintain blood glucose. However, when we talk about protein malnutrition, we refer to a long-term deficiency in protein intake. In our rich post-industrialized countries, long-term protein deficiency is not a common problem because we already eat more than what is required, so we're generally safe. And even if we go on weird diets, weight loss diets, unbalanced eating patterns, we may have deficiencies of vitamins and minerals, but we will still have enough proteins in the long term. There are, however, some segments of the population that are more at risk for protein deficiency. People living in poverty, for a variety of reasons, including the fact that high-quality protein food tends to be the most expensive, but also a general lack of nutrition education. The elderly, again in part because of economic issues, but also especially if they live alone, they may be less hungry or not motivated to eat, to cook for themselves. Maybe they have trouble chewing or swallowing, their taste is different, so they may not enjoy eating and therefore not have adequate calories and proteins. Alcoholism is a risk factor. Alcohol is not a nutrient, but it provides a lot of calories and it also suppresses appetite. So these people are often not hungry and they don't eat enough, missing a bunch of nutrients, including proteins. Eating disorders, especially anorexia nervosa, carries a risk for protein malnutrition together with everything else that we already know. And then hospitalization, because remember, when you are ill or recovering, your protein needs can be way higher, but diet is not always the first concern of the medical team, and so the patient may not be getting enough proteins. Long-term protein deficiency is a big problem in many developing countries. And here the problem is twofold. Food is often scarce and of poor protein quality, since diets are mostly grain-based. But at the same time, protein needs are also higher than average to fight disease and infections, often because of food safety issues, contaminated food and water, undercooked food, or badly preserved food, leading to bacterial, fungal, and parasitic infections. And children are especially at risk for this because they already need more proteins for growth, and they are more vulnerable to infections. In most cases, if you're not getting enough proteins, you're also not getting enough food in general, so not enough calories as well. And so we refer to this problem as protein energy malnutrition. The consequences of protein deficiencies are impaired or stunted growth, as indicated by height and weight that are not adequate for age, and the brain will not be able to fully develop, leading to mental retardation that can sometimes be irreversible. But protein deficiency is a problem for adults as well. Protein turnover slows down, and the person is not able to carry on with all the structural and regulatory functions of proteins. Proteins are stolen from the lean mass to make glucose and energy, leading to muscle wasting and increasing weakness. Inadequate tissue repair leads to organ damage. Impaired immunity leads to increasing inability to fight infections, which may very well result in death. The tip of the iceberg of protein malnutrition are two conditions that are kwashiorkor and marasmus. Kwashiorkor is primarily a disease of protein deficiency. Protein is not enough, although you may still be getting enough energy, generally from a diet that is based on grains. Kwashiorkor is a word from Ghana that means the disease that a child gets when the next child is born. What happens is that the older child switches from breastfeeding to a cereal-based diet that is likely inadequate in proteins. If this is combined with a pre-existing infection, which further raises the need for protein, then the child is definitely not getting enough protein. He may still have some fat tissue, some muscle, but the characteristic sign of kwashiorkor is the swollen abdomen, which is definitely not abdominal fat, but it's fluid building up in the abdominal region, a condition known as ascites. We already know how albumin in the bloodstream maintains fluid balance. If plasma protein is low, then the osmotic pressure to recall fluids back into the circulation is too weak, and fluids start leaking and building up in the interstitial space, causing edema. You can see this boy has edema in his feet and leg also, but the same happens in his abdomen as well. Hepatic steatosis, or fat liver, further contributes to the dramatic abdominal swelling. You know that the liver can make lipids starting from carbohydrates, but then to send them around to muscle cells, it has to package them into the lipoproteins. But if it doesn't have proteins, it cannot make lipoproteins. And so these lipids will never be able to even leave the liver, which will start accumulating them. Marasmus is a full protein and energy deficiency. So here you're not just not getting enough proteins, but also not enough lipids, not enough carbs, not enough anything, you're starving. This leads to complete muscle wasting and organ damage, a complete depletion of adipose stores, bone loss, and a general wasting of body tissues. All that's left is basically skin and bones. Most metabolic processes slow down or completely stop. Growth is severely stunted, and there is a dramatically higher susceptibility to infection and disease, and death resulting from these infections, which the body is not strong enough to fight.